And it is water.
I was checking if it was a large shot of vodka.
Yeah. Gin. Okay, for gin.
My name is Rajay Rai. I'm the Chief Information Officer of Trust Bank in Singapore, powered by Standard Chartered Bank.
I'm Kerry Harrison. I am a director in client services at Thought Machine, and I run a global team responsible for building accelerators to speed up the process of clients going live on Vault.
I would say when you're thinking about launching a bank, the first thing you think about is build security into your design. That's fundamental, right? Compliance and security can be built as code. It's important that you can move fast and think differently about how you apply continuous compliance, continuous security, really, really important across every layer of your application, your platform. And with that, of course, think in terms of data, an operating model that suits and aligned with how you would build yourself a platform and a bank on the cloud, which includes, you know, entirely your thinking, rethinking people, processes, technology, how do they fit in, culture, really important.
Just on that, one of the other things I was thinking is general open-mindedness. So when you're launching something new and completely different to what you've been doing before, is don't make sure that you're open-minded with the challenges that can come. Try not to think about all the challenges that you've got, but to think about what do I really want to get to? What do I really want to deliver? But without thinking of all the issues that you've got, all the incumbent problems that you have to deal with, but to be open-minded with what you really want to get to. What do you actually really want to deliver? And to look forward and not be too constrained with your current problems that you've got.
Yeah, I do agree with you on that one. I shouldn't use the word fail fast, but I should say try and learn fast,
yep.
Right? And listen to data, listen to what's going on around you, and try and think in terms of how you can pivot, change your direction at any point,
yep,
in time. That's why it's important to be nimble.
Yeah, the exact same word I was just thinking. Nimble is exactly the right word. Absolutely, yes. What I find quite interesting about the front end development that's gone on in recent years is a lot of the kind of big incumbent banks have been focusing on just overhauling the front end in terms of user experience. So we got all our nice apps as consumers, and it looked like the banks had moved forward. But actually, without revolutionising the core technology that they were using, they were only ever going to be able to make it look shiny to an end consumer, and they never were be able to give them the functionality they really needed. So I think by actually overhauling your core, replacing it with the latest cloud tech, forward-thinking technology, it actually empowers the end user to do more than they've ever done before. It's not just a shiny new app. You get all the functionality that you've never had before.
Yeah, totally agree, you know. It's more about data in motion, because when we think about the experiences today, everything is real-time around us.
Yeah.
If I'm going to a coffee machine every morning and I'm tapping it in the same shop, the same location, and it costs $3.50, why would you constantly give me that notification?
Mm-hmm.
Could we not just say, hey, you've tapped this 3 times in the same shop every morning, right? And it could get noisy for the customer, but you could automatically tell the customer, hey, you know what, would you like to suppress this notification? Because we know this location is maybe outside your office or outside your house, and you're going to do that every morning. And say, would you like to suppress this? Yes or no? Right? Simple experiences. But we all know simplicity is really complex to deliver, right? And that kind of information requires contextual information where you are, and also some history, right, on what you did in the last 3 occasions in the same location, same shop, same coffee shop. Now, that's called historical, contextual historical information, right? That's the kind of engine you need today. Hence, you need a platform that actually is more aligned with providing you with that flow. And it's called a streaming platform. Mm. That's what you call it. You can embed analytics on that stream of data that's continuously flowing, right? Natively embed all of these using cloud-native technology. So it makes it far, far less effort for you to build these rich experiences in future. So yeah, of course your call is important, right?
Yeah.
It's got to fit into that.
Yeah, and it's a good point as well. It's not just what the consumers want now. I mean, we are consumers, we're demanding. We want the next thing now. Like, what's coming next? Give it to me now. And you can't do that with the existing limitations that are there on those platforms. Being able to constantly move forward as the consumers are demanding more and more every day, I think it's vitally important.
Yeah, and again, coming back to, you know, what you just said, the main thing we want to deliver the customers is insights, oversights, and foresights. Insights are, where did my data go? How do I perform against my budget? But even what's more important, I think, is foresights, which is, hey, you know what? You're going to not have enough money to pay your rent. I mean, that's where you really want to be in terms of experiences. And same goes with this band, right? Most of these watches you wear, they tell you everything about you. But this band, which is a Whoop band, by the way, I love this, highly recommend it. It will tell you what you should do, yeah. Right? So I think there's a difference in
next step.
How you think about the next step. Or, you know, thinking about what you need to give your customers for better financial health, right? So you need to be a bit more predictive.
Yeah.
For that, you need analytics.
Absolutely.
It's really important. Now, that's a hard one. I think the hardest part for banks, right, is to iterate quickly, test and learn, be more experimental, right? Listen to what's happening, churn out solutions as soon as possible. And having to do that in an iterative manner is quite challenging, because traditional organizations don't have the culture, right, to move fast. So the whole organization needs to understand that, needs to embrace the new ways of working. And the technologies don't lend themselves to the culture as well, because if you're moving fast, you're thinking of automation, you're thinking of iteratively going into production, right, at a faster pace. You've got to rethink your entire software development life cycle. And that development life cycle needs to align with the operating system, your model actually, your operating model of the cloud. I think speed is really important, and speed is what traditional banks cannot do, because they don't have the right people, process, and technologies put together in order to move fast, and especially to cope with, you know, the demands of the customers, ever-changing demands of the customers.
I mean, I was going to say, obviously, a cutting-edge core banking platform is a must, a good starter. But it's not just the technology as well. I mean, to your point as well, the culture element is huge. It's having that mindset to move quickly, look at the challenges, adjust, adapt, and the speed of making those changes and embracing them, and not being, you know, similar to what we were saying earlier as well, not being caught up with all of the challenges, but to kind of understand the art of the possible. So to be like, we've got the technology, we've made the cultural changes, our mindset is changing, we can do this, we can be nimble in terms of the approach to doing it. So I think it's a combination of all of those things for sure. You know, I really do think that a cutting-edge core banking platform is always a good start. I think looking at the technology is a great place to do it. But we have just hit on this in terms of the mindset, but it is really important in terms of the change and what you want to do. Being able to look at things that you've done in the past and approach them slightly differently. So looking at even your products, understanding how your product management process works, instead of working in silos across each of your different product sets and have been limited to focusing, okay, this is the product, this is where we're going. To be able to actually understand how that works across all of them. Buy now, pay later is a great example. You know, rather than being struggling to turn around the changes and the demands that are coming in the market, to be able to look at what's needed, what are consumers after, turn that around quickly, being able to adapt to that change, being able to look across your product set, understand what you can leverage, what you can pull from, adapt and move quickly to make those changes to the end consumer.
Yeah, I think I like the way you mentioned the example of BNPL. Right. That's, again, real time. When you think about traditional ways of thinking, you're thinking, I need to apply for a loan, right, first. Here you're thinking, I want a car, I want, you know, a fridge, or whatever. And you kind of make the process of getting a credit card, a plastic credit card, invisible, right? And it's frictionless now, because you're making decisions in real time when, at the moment, right, the customer needs it. So I think that's the way forward, real time, and comes back to your main engine, right? Mm-hmm. Being, and the brain being real time as well. And that's why you need a core, of course. You need a core that's real time. And that's not batched, right? Yeah. Traditionally, you would think about batch processes, and the effort to move, you know, data at rest into data at motion was already hard. So you're right in terms of making sure your the heart of the organization is beating correctly, right? It's got the right technology there. But, you know, also I think it's moving away from being product-centric to more human-centered. It's not about output-based. It's more about value that you can give to the customers. And we talked about that,
yeah,
right? Being
absolutely.
More predictable, making being more data-centered, right,
yeah.
For your customers, human-centered around what can we do to the customer, how can we enrich the value
yeah.
and the lives of our customers differently. I mean, it's flipping it around, you know. 2030, did you say?
Yeah.
Digital I hope I'm alive. I'm 51. So I got to last to 60, right? So I think the future is going to be about speed and trust using data, I would say intelligently.
Mm-hmm.
I think, again, the word AI is overused, and so is, you know, all the analytical words. So should I say intelligently?
Yep.
Right? With a lot of intelligence to help the customers. So those principles are around which everything is going to be based off, right? Above that, I think it's the operating model, and it's more, everything is going to be cloud. So having a cloud operating model is important. That goes again with, you know, you have agility, you have speed, you have everything as code, including your security compliance, your continuously compliant and secure. And then you think in terms of the business architecture. I would say the two architectures, right? In the business, you're thinking in terms of banking as a service that's becoming really, which will become really popular due to the fact that open banking is here. And of course, the other side, you have banking as a platform. In one of them, you have a banking as a service where the bank is invisible, and banking as a platform where the bank is more visible,
mm-hmm.
and you're unbundling and bundling new products and capabilities in an ecosystem. And more, everything is around contextualization, right? So you're embedding these services like BNPL and other mm-hmm. services into non-banking journeys. That's going to be really popular. And of course, making sure that, you know, you're more conscious in your banking and providing better value to your customers and financial health.
Mm-hmm.
But all of this, I think, is important. But the operating model, right, based on the cloud is going to be really popular. And should I dare say that the future is about double-clicking and turning on a banking experience, right,
yeah.
and a banking service. It should be that easy in future. And if you see, you know, Thought Machine today, right, it's headless. I think it's like a Lego block. The options are infinite in what you can build with these headless banks today and the capabilities
yes.
that comes with the core. So yeah, it's exciting where this could go, but I see this future about double clicking and turning on a banking services, and it's not too far in my mind.
Yeah, opportunities are endless. I think for me it's kind of three things. I think completely digital is obvious. I think customer driven is another, and where all the banks are going to be in 2013, I think the third one's an easy one. They're all going to be on Vault, right? I mean, that's it. Done.
Love that.
Yeah,
isn't it?
Totally. World domination by Vault. But yeah, I completely agree with everything you said. The opportunities for all of this is the art of the possible. It's here. It's now. I mean, you know, with some of the vendors we're speaking to, the opportunities of, you know, how you can provide these experiences to our customers. You know, again, looking at the not just what's there from the core point of view, but plugging that into some other very exciting pieces of technology that are coming into the market, being able to provide those really exciting kind of cutting edge customer experiences directly to the consumers, I think is going to be very exciting. So yeah, for me, I think 2013 is going to be brilliant from a banking point of view for consumers, for sure.